After we have performed the initial steps to two samples, it is time to integrate them. We use canonical correlation analysis to align the samples. After this, the samples are joined into one R object and treated similarly as in the basic one sample analysis. The data is scaled, PCA is used to reduce the dimensions, after which we can again cluster the cells and visualize our clustering results. Canonical correlation analysis, or CCA, is yet another dimension reduction method, like PCA. But unlike in PCA, we are not trying to find the directions where there is most variance in the data, but rather capture the common sources of variation between the datasets. Instead of principal component vectors, we get canonical correlation vectors as result.
These vectors represent the genes that best define the shared biological space between the samples.
So unlike with PCA, which was identifying sources of variation, we now look for similarities with CCA. These similarities help us to integrate or align our datasets. Let's take a little bit closer look on the aligning process used by the Seurat version 3 tools. These pictures are borrowed from the publication by Seurat developers, which is linked here. Here we can see two samples that are, as you can see, not aligned but affected by the batch effect, the sample-to-sample variation. The process starts by performing the canonical correlation analysis. After CCA, the canonical correlation vectors are normalized. After these two steps, we have projected the dataset into a subspace, which is defined by the shared correlation structures of the datasets. Now, in this shared space, anchors are identified. These anchors, represented here as gray lines, are cell pairs that share mutual nearest neighbors across the datasets. These anchors will guide the integration. In some cases, there are unique cell populations that are only present in one of the samples. These could cause problems in the integration process. This is why each anchor pair is scored based on the consistency of its neighborhood. The incorrect anchors, shown here and here in red, tend to have low scores and are then downweighted in the analysis. The last step is to use these anchors and their scores to compute the correction vectors for each cell. After the correction, the expression values of each cell are transformed so that they can be jointly analyzed. The information of which sample the cell originally came from is naturally stored, as well as the meaningful biological variance. The attempt here is to remove just the batch effect and make the comparison between the samples possible. In Chipster, we offer two parameters for this combination step. The first parameter, number of CCs to use in the neighbor search, is used in the anchor identification step. The second parameter gives the number of principal components to use in the anchor weighting process. Both have a default value of 20, and you can well start with those default values. After combining the samples, we cluster them and visualize the clusters, as we learned in the one sample analysis pipeline. Here, too, we have the same parameters for clustering and plotting. You can check the video about clustering to remind yourself about the different parameters. One of the parameters is for the number of principal components to include in the clustering step. Now, this might feel like a yet another layer of dimension reduction, as PCA and CCA were already used in the integration of the datasets, and TSNE and UMAP will be used for the visualization of the clustering results. That feeling is justified, but you've got this. This is just the normal true dimensionality estimation that we learned in the one sample analysis pipeline. In the one sample pipeline, we used the heat maps and the elbow plot to estimate the number of meaningful principal components. Now, in the article where the integration step is described, the Seurat developers say that they neglect to finely tune this parameter for each dataset, but still observe robust performance over diverse use cases. After which, they propose a certain number of pieces to use in different cases. Again, testing and comparing is the way to go. And if you have a significantly larger dataset or increased heterogeneity in your samples, go ahead and try higher numbers.